Here we have a 3x4 matrix. What are we interested in doing? Kind of like the take-home exam problem, we're interested in finding the kernel and image of the corresponding linear transformation. We're going to define a linear transformation, which is a function, from, okay, with a matrix like this, 3 rows and 4 columns, the domain of the linear transformation has to be 4-dimensional, the number of columns. And the codomain has to be 3-dimensional, the number of rows. First question is why? Well, and how are we defining this linear transformation? By the equation T of X equals A times X, where that is a matrix times a vector. And notice very carefully, I said T of X, not T times X. I said T of X. And I said A times X, not A of X. T is a function name, not a number, not a matrix. I'm plugging a vector into it, a 3-dimensional vector, or excuse me, a 4-dimensional vector. This is an element of 4-dimensional space. Yes, you could write its components as, say, x1, x2, x3, x4. And it doesn't matter that we can't visualize it. We can still write the column vector. We can still write the numbers down. It still makes sense as a mathematical object that we can do algebra with and we can think about and maybe has applications. So that input vector is 4-dimensional. That's why the domain of this is 4-dimensional. This notation means T is a function with this set as its domain and this set as its codomain. T is mapping vectors in 4-dimensional space to 3-dimensional space. How? It's like the test question. With this particular matrix, there's your first column, call it little a1. Here's your second column, call it little a2. Here's your third column, call it little a3. And here's your fourth column, call it little a4. And those are vectors. I'm trying to emphasize that by putting the little half arrow above them. And by definition, just like on the test, A times X, which is T of X, is a linear combination of these columns with these entries, these components as the coefficients or weights. T of X equals A times X equals little x1, the first component, times a1, which I'll go ahead and use this specific vector, 330, plus little x2 times a2, -7, -9, 3, plus little x3 times a3, 8, 12, -6, plus little x4 times a4, -5, -9, and 6. That is what the formula for this linear transformation. It's not the only formula. You can also multiply these components times each, multiply these weights, x1 through x4 times the components in these vectors. And you can get, if you do that and combine all the vectors, a first component of 3x1 minus 7x2 plus 8x3 minus 5x4 for the first component, 3x1 minus 9x2 plus 12x3 minus 9x4 for the second, and 0x1, which I won't bother writing, plus 3x2 minus 6x3 plus 6x4 for the third component. This is a 3-dimensional vector. It is an element of R3. This funny thing means is an element of, or is in for short. What are the kernel and what's the image? kernel is the set of everything in the domain that gets mapped to the zero vector. Corresponds to a solution set of what's called a homogeneous system of equations, where all the right-hand side constants are zeros. For sure, the zero vector is in the kernel. For sure, the zero vector gets mapped to the zero vector. You replace all those x's with zero, you will get the zero vector in three-dimensional space. But could there be more than just the zero vector in the kernel? Here's a little intuition. Since we're going from a higher dimensional space to a lower dimensional space, it's kind of like this function is collapsing, you might say, the spatial extent of the domain to a lower dimensional space. And that, I'm telling you, is supposed to be some intuition that the kernel probably includes more than the zero vector. In fact, it definitely does. If the dimensions of these two spaces were the same, maybe it includes more than the zero vector, maybe it doesn't. If this one were a bigger dimension, maybe the kernel would include more than the zero vector, maybe it wouldn't. But for sure, if we go from a high dimensional space to a lower dimensional space, for sure the kernel will contain more vectors than just the zero vector. What's the image? And is this function one-to-one and or onto? Let's talk about the one-to-one first. Since the kernel is going to contain more than the zero vector, there will be non-zero vectors in four-dimensional space that get mapped to the zero vector in three-dimensional space. There will be non-trivial solutions of setting these equal to zero. There will be free variables. Since that's the case, that's going to mean this function is not one-to-one. There's more than one vector that gets mapped to the zero vector. It can't be one-to-one. What's the image and will it be onto? Listen really carefully. If you're going from a higher dimensional space to a lower dimensional space, and the entries of your matrix are essentially random, in all likelihood, with probability very close to one, the image will be in the entire codomain, all of three-dimensional space in this example, and it will be onto. However, if these are not random, and the professor picks numbers in a certain special way, which I actually did here, it's possible the image, the set of all outputs, will not be all of the codomain. There will be some vectors that are not possible outputs, and the function will not be onto. And that's actually what does happen. Let's describe the image first. That's a very generic description that doesn't give you a ton of insight, but is still valid. To describe the image, it's best to just say it's the set of all linear combinations of these columns. That's what you did on your exam. Right, that's what I told you to do on the take home. The image of T could be described as a set, as the collection of all these vectors. I'll just draw an arrow to save time. As the weights, x1, x2, x3 and x4 vary over all real numbers. They are elements of the real number system. That is the simplest way to describe the image. It is a valid description. Doesn't give you much insight into what it is, how to visualize it, but it is valid. And at this point, that's good enough for us. I will tell you, though, that because I picked these numbers in a special way, again, this function is not going to be onto. This will not be all of three-dimensional space. It'll be, I will tell you, I'm just informing you, it'll be a two-dimensional plane through the origin in three-dimensional space. Not at all obvious that that's true. It seems like you should be able to get every possible three-dimensional vector as you vary these x's here. Listening carefully. Every single word I try to say is important. It looks like you should be able to get all three-dimensional space as you vary the x's. But I'm just telling you that won't happen. You're just believing me. That's good enough for the moment. What about the kernel? Well, first of all, by definition, the kernel is the set of all elements in the domain, which is four-dimensional space, such that T of x is zero, and that's the three-dimensional zero vector in R3. The vertical lines in the set builder notation just mean such that, or with the property. Shorthand notation. But how do you describe the kernel more specifically? That's where you need row operations to get to something called reduced row echelon form, identifying free variables and solving. It was in lecture 8B. You should have watched as you're working on the take home. With a 3x3 example, I believe. You need to take your matrix, your A, and enter it in your calculator. Ideally is what's called an augmented matrix, where you got a bunch of zeros on the right. In Mathematica, if I want to do that, here's on this writing assistant, there's a matrix button right here I can click. If I want to add columns to this matrix, do a control comma. If you want to add rows, do control return. You might want to write that down. Control return gave me an extra row, and that's how many rows I want. How many columns do I want? Well, if I'm doing the matrix A itself, I want to stop there at a 3x4 matrix. And I'm going to call this A augmented. I'm going to add an extra column that's going to be all zeros. Do a control comma when your cursor is in one of these squares to make an extra column, and do control return to get an extra row. So I'm entering A here. We're almost done. Hang with me here. And putting zeros on the right. So this is not technically A itself because I'm adding those zeros on the right. But I think conceptually speaking, it's good to imagine this to be an augmented matrix that corresponds to a system of linear equations where you have set all these things equal to zero. When I write these things by hand, I put a dashed line before the column on the right. In Mathematica or your calculator, you can't do that. On a calculator, you do RREF. In Mathematica, you do matrix form, row reduce, capitalized as you see, and put your augmented matrix in there. And here's what we get. This is reduced row echelon form. Maybe you haven't been watching the videos and you have no idea what I'm talking about. RREF. What in the world is it? Essentially, I'm trying to solve the system of equations by doing multiplying certain equations by constants and adding them to other equations to eliminate variables. Effectively, this first line here means one times x1, minus 2x3. There's no x2 term because the coefficient of x2 is 0. Plus 3x4 equals 0. I'll write that down. We've got 1 minute. It's worth taking this 1 minute here. x1 minus 2x3 plus 3x4 equals 0. The second row says x2 minus 2x3 plus 2x4 equals 0. And the third row says 0 equals 0, so you don't need to write it down. Here's what I just wrote down. in this system of equations, two equations and four unknowns has the same solution set as the original system where you set all these equal to zero. And x3 and x4, since they don't have coefficients that are leading ones, are called free variables. And what you want to do is you want to solve for x1 and x2 in terms of x3 and x4. And the fact that there's two free variables means the kernel's two-dimensional. And without explaining why, it also turns out that that's why the image is two-dimensional. Those don't necessarily have to equal each other in general, but they do in this case. I know that's stuff that's complicated conceptually and fast. Watch the videos, do the reading. We'll come back and talk about it more on Friday with the CPN Friday. Have a good day.